Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and I'm here today at the James Julia Auction House taking a look at some of the gigantic anti-tank weapons that they are going to be selling in their upcoming spring of 2018 firearms auction. And this is an M20 recoilless rifle. And despite the look, this was actually developed and introduced just at the end of World War II. Now, the issue that this was developed to address was that of rapidly increasing tank armor. So we all know that during World War II, you know, at the very beginning, tanks had really quite remarkably light armor, such that, in fact, most countries had some sort of man-portable, approximately 50 caliber anti-tank rifle that could be used to effectively incapacitate light tanks, or really the tanks that were in use. And by the end of the war, you've got things like German Tiger IIs that are impenetrable to virtually everything. So the U.S., first off, didn't have an anti-tank rifle at the beginning of the war and kind of had to play catch-up, developed a Bazooka, the 2.36-inch Bazooka, which was okay, but quickly became not powerful enough. So they replaced that with the Super Bazooka, which was a 3.5-inch Bazooka. That was better, but still not powerful enough for a lot of the armor that was coming out. So U.S. ordnance began to experiment with the concept of a recoilless rifle. And the idea here is you have a gigantic cartridge, and it's perforated in the case body, and there are vent holes in the back of the breech. And so, the problem is, if you were to fire this out of a typical sealed breech rifle sort of gun, the recoil would be absolutely tremendous, because all of the pressure that builds up to fire a, in this case, a 75mm, 22-pound, a 10-kilo projectile, all that energy is going to be transmitted into recoil in the gun. So one of the alternatives, what they call a recoilless, is to not try to contain that pressure at all. And what you're basically doing, this is kind of like a rocket, except it just gets one big burst of propellant gas. So when the powder charge in this detonates, it explodes here, and then it has two places that it can go. One is forward, but it has to move the projectile in order to do that, and one is backward. Well, simply because it can't all escape out the back at once, half of that pressure gets transmitted into the projectile and it goes flying out the muzzle. The rest of it vents out the back of the gun. As a result, you don't have to try and make the back end of this thing strong enough to actually contain all of that pressure while the projectile is going up the barrel. That allows you to make the weapon a whole lot lighter and more portable. So instead of having something that, you know, requires a five-man crew and has a big wheeled carriage and has to have a truck to tow it, as you would get with a 75mm artillery piece, instead, you get something that weighs, in total with its mount, 114.5 pounds, 52 kilos, something that can actually be more or less transported by a team of two or three men on foot. Now, when the U.S. started working on this, they actually worked on a variety of different calibers, and in fact, the first one was a 57mm gun that was actually shoulder-fired. That developed well and actually went into production as the M18 and did see use at the very end of World War II, starting in about March of 45. And when they were developing that gun, the Ordnance Department looked at it and said, this looks pretty good. We should develop it in several other calibers as well. And so in addition to 57mm, they developed versions in 75mm and 105mm. This, being the 75, was adopted as the M20, and went into service right about the same time, March of 1945. So these saw just a little bit of use right at the end of World War II. They then saw substantial use in the Korean War, and they were kind of just on their way out in the Vietnam War, being replaced by guided missiles, basically, wire-guided missiles. So this fired a 75mm or 3-inch projectile weighing about 22 pounds. It had a couple different types of ammunition. They had high explosive armor piercing, and they had a white phosphorus round, which was used to create smoke clouds. And with the armor piercing round, they could penetrate, it was a shaped charge, so it didn't really depend on velocity, but they could penetrate about 4 inches of armor, which, even for something this size, wasn't really totally capable of taking out a Soviet T-34, which was one of the main enemy tanks in use in the Korean War. So, still not a totally capable anti-tank weapon in Korea, although it was pretty darn good at the end of World War II. The effective range of this was about 400 yards. in theory, the maximum range is like 7,000, but effective range for a point target was about 400, maybe 1,000 yards with the high explosive ammunition. Speaking of which, unfortunately, I don't have the optics here to show you, but this actually has a mount for two different optics. It had a direct fire optic for basically shooting at tanks, and it had an indirect fire optic, which would have been used for the high explosive rounds. The indirect fire optic allowing you to angle the gun up substantially and aim at a target where you're dropping the round down onto your target. The mount for this, what we have here in a rather clever, maybe obvious, but clever decision, was to use the mount for a model of 1917 A1 machine gun. The US still had plenty of those around in World War II, and it makes a nice convenient mount. So the pintle is identical to the pintle for a 1917 machine gun. This just drops in, and that's a nice easy solution without having to develop a whole new mount. You'll notice it's actually pointing 180 degrees the opposite direction that a machine gun would. If you had a 1917 machine gun on this, it'd be pointing that way. This allows you to angle it up reasonably substantially with this long barrel on it. And that was the primary ground mount. These were also mounted on vehicles, jeeps primarily. The 105mm ones were too big for a machine gun mount. They were primarily on vehicles, as well as having, I believe, a wheeled carriage. Let me go ahead and show you a bit of a close-up on the breech mechanism, how that works, and a few other details. All right, so the way you would go about actually firing this is, well, first we have our breech block back here, and you can see the four very large vent holes where all the propellant gas comes out the back. So you would take your projectile here. Now this is obviously just an empty case, and just FYI, the projectile on this thing comes out to, like, here. It's almost as long as the case itself. It's huge. So, you take this and you rotate it about 45 degrees, and then it pivots open like that. We have a firing pin hole down here and a little cartridge extractor. You then take your case, slide it gently into the chamber there. This one's got a bunch of preservative grease inside, so I'm not going to try and chamber an old empty cartridge. Anyway, once you've got that in, you then close the breech block. And by the way, you don't do it like this. What you would do is actually, I don't know if you'll be able to see this, you would get back here so that you are not behind the action. Close it, rotate to lock. That's a very important part. You know, I can't really overemphasize just how dangerous the back end of these things is. Remember, literally as much blast comes out here as comes out the front end. So, once it's locked and in position, then we've got our trigger mechanism. The trigger for this is right here on the left-hand breech handle. So, we have a button there. There is a safety device to it. You can rotate this. That's safe. That's ready to fire. Hear that click, that is the firing pin dropping, and that sets off a tremendous kaboom. Here's a bit of a close-up on the optics mount. It's a pretty complicated affair here, but basically what you have are two different dovetail mounts. So you'd have your direct fire sight slide in here, your indirect fire sight slide in there, and that allows you to use this both in an anti-tank role and in an anti-personnel or bombardment sort of long-range role. Gross adjustment of your elevation is done with the pintle mount on the tripod here. So this allows you to pivot it up and down, as well as, of course, changing the angle of the legs. And then fine adjustment to the elevation is done with this control wheel here, which just threads this up and down. Yeah, I don't quite have that pin all the way through, but that's how it all works. These were pretty hot stuff in World War II. In the Korean War, they weren't that great, that useful for armor, but they were still quite effective on pillboxes, fortifications, light vehicles, and that sort of thing. By the Vietnam War, these were really on their way out. They were being replaced by more effective, more modern weapon systems. However, these do actually still have a role, and they are still in use to this very day, every winter. These are the guns that are used in a lot of places for avalanche control. Deliberately setting off controlled avalanches before they can accumulate enough snowpack to get really big and destructive. So the National, I believe it's the National Park Service, actually maintains a number of these, and that is what they use to set off controlled avalanches. So pretty cool ongoing use, a pretty cool use for something that is an obsolete military weapon. Can use it for basically public safety use today. So if you're interested in owning this one, whether you need to prevent avalanches at your house or you just want to have a really cool and actually shootable vintage destructive device, this is an NFA registered destructive device. So as long as you're willing to go through the NFA procedure to own it, you can certainly do so. Take a look at the description text below for a link to James Julia's catalog page on this piece. That has their pictures, description, has a couple other accessories that come with it in addition to the gun itself, and value and everything else that you would need to know to place a bid on it either through their website or live here at the auction. Thanks for watching.